Meet the Hellcat, the F6F, a single-engine, semi-low-wing combat airplane equipped for use on Navy aircraft carriers or as a land-based fighter.
My impression of the Hellcat was it was a very workmanlike airplane. A brute of an aircraft, in some respects, but tough as they come. An all-singing, all-dancing fighter airplane, capable of delivering bombs, rockets, machine guns, doing reconnaissance work, and therefore suitable to be earmarked for any theatre in the world. You could take quite a number of hits from a machine gun into the engine and it would survive. So it was a brute of an aircraft, but it was a very effective aircraft. It was effective because it had good range, good visibility. It was reliable. It was a thoroughbred deck landing aeroplane.
Oh, it was a marvellous aeroplane. We'd all flown Wildcats a lot. And a Hellcat, I suppose you could say, was a Wildcat times two. It was about twice the size, twice the power. A very robust aeroplane, ideal for deck landing purposes. A marvellous gun platform, and quite capable of being a fighter bomber, a dive bomber, and an aeroplane capable of firing rockets and all sorts of things. So it was an excellent aeroplane. Very user-friendly, we might say.
Well, I do understand that Grumman, who made the Hellcat, had a very good liaison with the people who actually flew the aircraft for which they were designed. And so the feedback that they had from pilots in the previous Grumman aircraft was such that they made the Hellcat a very good airplane indeed. It was robust, it was tough, it had a Pratt & Whitney double wasp engine, which was as strong as a horse. It was a very good airplane indeed. Much better than previous aircraft, much better than the Corsair. But it's never perfect, but it was good. I was very privileged to fly it.
Well, of course, yes, because the British never did design naval aircraft, basically. I mean, that's why the Fleet Air Arm had suffered from ever since its existence, basically, that nobody designed naval aircraft. They designed them for the RAF and then said, oh, well, these guys, they can fly them, they're not very different. Just modify it, put a hook on it, fold the wing, and away you go. Now, American, the thing about American naval aircraft, they were designed to be used as naval aircraft on carriers. Though one has to say, having said that, that the Corsair was designed for that, but then signally failed to do it. As far as the Americans were concerned, we did it, and it actually worked very well for us in the Pacific and was a very effective fighter in the BPF. In the next stage of my career, if I can call it that, was flying Hellcats. Ironically, when I went to Trincomalee, I was flying Wildcats, was my aircraft I flew the most, and I became totally at home with it. I could, you know, fly it in my sleep. So that the Hellcat was in a way, a much easier airplane to fly. It had a decent undercarriage, whereas the Wildcat had a very narrow undercarriage. It didn't do it, had no nasty tricks, nasty habits, and was a comfortable firing platform, whether it was air firing or bombing or whatever. The Hellcat, I must say, I got to like, but it was very gentlemanly aeroplane compared to the Wildcat. The Wildcat was lively and fun. You felt more of a fighter aircraft. The Hellcat was very heavy, what I call heavy American style.
Oh, it's a beautiful aeroplane. Have an ashtray. It had a plotting board, you pull out about this big with a large sandwich computer nut on, So it was beautiful fly. You got armoured back, armoured seat. You can see them. I don't know whether you saw the fighting lady. There's a Hellcat on that lands on, and it sort of sheds its wings and it sheds its nose and it finishes up. And I've seen it quite a few times to finish up with just the cockpit there intact, very rugged, beautiful airplane. It was, I mean, the Hellcat and the Corsair were the main American aircraft. The Corsair had I think it was about 14 feet high, but it had this gold wing and a very long nose. And you had to have your seat right up for a deck landing. And you also had to keep it in the turn all the way. Well, if you've got it a turn at all, with the nose up on a deck landing, they lost the ship. So they were quite tricky, of course. The Hellcat was quite good. Quite good deck landing.
Grumman Hellcat was a lovely, solid, built aeroplane, excellent deck landing aircraft. Good weapon carrier, manoeuvrable, much liked by all who flew it. Although many preferred the Corsair, which was a faster aeroplane and very ideal for fighter cover compared with the Hellcat. It was operating, Corsairs operated as high cover, Hellcats as medium cover.
Well, I mean, the Seafire was much more manoeuvrable. If it came to a dogfight, the Seafire would win every time, except possibly with the ME-109, but even there it had the upper hand. Not with the Zero. The Zero had no armor plating when he was very light because they didn't worry about the pilots too much. But the Hellcat was much heavier and therefore he couldn't turn quite so. I did once have a brush with a Zero in the Hellcat and I realized I wasn't going to win very much. So I'll come to that later. That was out in Sumatra.
Well, in South Africa, we had 7 months there, converted to Hellcats. First, it was quite interesting. The first one, the Hellcats had pneumatic brakes, like an airbag expanded and pushed metal plates together, like this rubbed the hell together. And it was a long, long taxi from air dispersal round to taxiway. So the first two off got airborne after a long and slow taxi because it was the first time in the aircraft. And they came back and landed. They just flipped over on their backs. And apparently these had got very hot taxiing. And then they just rolled on the runway and took off. By the time they took off, they got so red hot, they just welded together. And when they landed, they got welded brakes. Because they were never designed for airfield operations, they were designed for just for carrier operation, which are good brakes for carriers, but it got very hot.
I remember one thing I do remember about this, the Hellcat was that it had a huge gun anyway, whatever it was, which worked, which pumped pretty large bullets out, pretty small shells out. If you had the gun jammed, then in most aircraft, that's it. You shrug your shoulders and say, well, that's the end of it. In the Hellcat, there was a bloody great push button pedal on the floor of the aircraft, and you kicked this thing. You gave this spring-loaded thing a great big kick, and 99 times out of 100, the jam, right, cleared itself, and you went on firing.
And you come in to land on a curved approach. even though in the Hellcat the visibility was very good for it. I think we'd all learnt then that the smart way to come into land on a carrier was on a curved approach, only straightening out right at the end, so that you could see the batsman all the way round. And we just did that sort of steady approach, coming down from 300 feet. We did the, it was the old British deck landing approach. It wasn't the American one, which I learned to do later on after the war, which was totally different. And we just came down very close to the stall, lots of engine, from about, I think it was 300 feet, as far as I recollect, and you just came steadily down on the last bit of the approach, once you more or less straightened out, in fact, with lots of power, and just coming down as you could, sort of right onto the three-point landing, if you could. Then we then had to unlearn all that later in the 50s when I did the American deck landings.
Lovely to deck land. You could float it round pretty straight in. Yeah, I think you could bounce it onto the deck. I mean, you've seen those those pictures of the Americans doing it. I can't say I ever saw one do it. I saw some later on in the Pacific that had been badly shot up, two bad landings, but that wasn't their fault. The whole thing was to get your whole flight on as quickly as possible. So you did it on the turn. The next one was already on the turn. Because the barrier has to go down, you've got to go forward and it's got to come up again. If he was too close, of course, the batsman would wave him around. But usually we could do it all right. It was good to practice, to come in one after the other. Because at the shortest time the ship was into wind, the better.
Now, with a British aircraft, you were stalled, and in a stall, semi-stall condition, and you had to make a landing because the aircraft was still gliding, particularly a seafire. So if you were a little bit fast, you missed the wires and hit the barrier. You had to be at the correct speed. With an American aircraft, most of them came down quickly once you closed the throttle. Even if they were a little bit fast, they still came down, and that's what you wanted. You wanted an aircraft to come down once the throttle was closed to hit the deck and get that hook caught in a wire.
I was beginning to get jittery about landings, and I had one or two near misses. Well, I think the worst one was one that decided me was when remember I was saying about how the seafire floated, and on one occasion I suppose I was a little bit too fast, and I started floating over the deck. Realized I was not going to come down at all, so I opened the throttle and went round again. I think the people on the barrier must have been quick enough to get the barrier down, otherwise my undercarriage would have caught in it. But anyway, I survived and came in, but the CO decided probably I'd be safer on Hellcats, which were much easier aircraft to land on. And the Hellcat, being designed as a fleet carrier, had the hook coming out aft of the tail wheel. Well, much heavier, but having a radial engine with the cylinders arranged in a round, in a circle, in a sphere, it was much easier. If you had a snub nose, you could see straight down, could see more easily. It was heavier, but the undercarriage was designed to not to bounce, to go bang and sit on the deck, whereas the Seafire, if you bounced, you did bounce, you know, if you hit a bit too hard, you just bounced up. But the Hellcat, with the wheels going folding outwards from the centre, was a much broader base. The oleos were tougher, and so if you hit the deck hard, they wouldn't bounce.
The oleos are the shock absorbers.
Yes. Like you get on the motorbike, on the front forks of a motorbike. And the hook came out at behind, as I say, at the back, so it was much easier to land on. Seafires, I think, it's true to say, there were more casualties, more aircraft losses from landings on deck and on bad hand, accidents from landing on, than there were from enemy action. Certainly that happened at Salerno, which was before I got into the action.
Quite good. It was mainly to get, you know, you do 400 feet, and you got your speed right back, so you got your nose up, and you fly on power, really. If you want to lose height, you ease the throttle back a bit. If you want to hold it, you put it on. You don't move the control panel, you keep it very well back, so you're flying what would be a stall attitude if your power was off. So as soon as you get the cut your power, you're stalled. And aiming to pick up number three wire. Of course, then they had wires and barriers, so every landing was a sort of controlled accident. I quite enjoyed deck landings. Well, normal takeoff, you would just open your throttle, and when you get the flag drop, you lift your brakes off and away you go. But rocket assist, if there wasn't enough wind, the rocket assist takeoff, you had four or six rockets mounted at an angle on your fuselage on a rack that you could release once you were airborne. And you got a starting point, and you got a chap, you put your brakes on, and you put on full throttle, and he keeps waving up to it on full throttle. And then when he drops the flag, you let your brakes off, and when you get the next flag, you press your rocket, and away you go. And gives you a good old boost.
But I suppose towards the end of one's service, one was more anxious, really, about taking off than one was anxious about landing. It was largely because the treatment of the engine for takeoff on a carrier is pretty rough. You have to take her up to almost maximum, and you slam it through at the last minute to get through. And if an engine isn't in very good order, it can cough and splatter, and that's the last thing you want on a takeoff, because you're quite likely to go in off the sharp end if you lose power. As far as taking off was concerned, we were very frequently catapulted off, especially as you had people on watch for enemy aircraft coming into the fleet. I think in all cases in those days it was hydraulics. And over a distance of about 60 feet, you accelerated from naught to about 80, something of that. So it was quite a vigorous urge. Well, you blacked out slightly when you left. You had to have your elbow firmly into your stomach, the elbow of the hand that was holding the stick, because if you didn't do that, the chances were that when you shot off, your arm came straight back, and of course you would have described a loop. So you had to stop this happening by keeping your elbow firmly in the stomach and your arm rigid. But it wasn't an entirely unpleasant sensation. You had to have oxygen right from deck level on these occasions. But I think this stopped the sort of greying out. It was a slight greying out. It wasn't a blackout.